He wasn't sure if he knew who Taylor Swift was.
I know.
All right.
Apparently she's dating a football player.
Yes.
The president met with the president of Israel yesterday in the Oval Office. This moment got a bit of attention, and it's not the only one that is kind of like this that we sometimes see, and I just want to play it for you.
Sure.
And we brought Israelis and Palestinians together at a political level, and Aqua and the whole Sharm.
Yes.
And as I affirmed to Prime Minister Netanyahu yesterday, America's commitment to Israel is firm.
John, this got a lot of attention. It got picked up in a lot of places. Why is it so hard to understand what the president is trying to say there?
I think he was very, very clear, Martha. First of all, our commitment to Israel's security is ironclad, not going to change. That doesn't mean that we don't have concerns. He doesn't have concerns, and he's expressed those about the significant changes that are afoot in the democratic institutions inside Israel. And the president spoke about that honestly with Prime Minister and with the president of Israel. But Israel is a deep and secure partner and friend in the region. We're going to do everything we can to make sure that they can continue to defend themselves.
So you didn't think there was any problem to communicate there? You didn't have any difficulty understanding what he was trying to say?
The president was very clear in that clip, and he's been very clear publicly and private with the Israeli leaders about what we're trying to do here.
Harvard Harris poll this month that found that 53% of the public, including a fourth of Democrats, believe, quote, Joe Biden was involved with his son in an illegal influence peddling scheme. There's, of course, evidence that the president interacted with his relatives, associates from China, Mexico, Kazakhstan, Russia, and Ukraine. So what do you say to the majority of Americans who believe that the president is himself corrupt?
Wow, Jesus.
Can I take that question?
The president has spoken to this. The president has spoken to this, and there's nothing to these claims.
On May 10th, they issued a report showing that the Biden family allegedly funneled $10 million into their bank accounts while Joe Biden was vice president. Members of the committee have said there may be several national security concerns at hand here with their alleged ties to the foreign countries. Admiral, have you read the report yourself, and do you personally think that there are any national security concerns here?
No and no.
Is there any responsibility for the president to be specific about, with the voters, about how long he thinks the United States should be willing to be involved in this? Should he be willing to say 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years? Like, how long, you know, does he commit the United States to being in this system, in this situation of what is costing tens and tens of billions of dollars on a regular basis?
For as long as it takes means for as long as it takes. And the president has been very, very honest about that. Every other leader on the call also, in their own way, emphasized their commitment. Again, for as long as it takes. And then on your first question, still no indication that there's been any kind of widespread corruption or inappropriate use of U.S. capabilities.
A report from the Pentagon's Inspector General last year found the U.S. government was unable to monitor weapons transfers in the early months of the war, in part because the American embassy's staff was evacuated. Criminal groups in Ukraine stole some weapons and equipment from the country's military. An American hotline for Ukrainians to report misuse of assistance from U.S. aid saw a tenfold increase when these posters went up across the country earlier this year. American officials are now investigating 4 criminal cases involving non-military aid. And 170 Ukrainian government officials, including high-ranking military officers, have been charged in corruption cases so far this year for crimes like embezzlement and accepting bribes. American taxpayers are financing more than just weapons. We discovered the US government's buying seeds and fertilizer for Ukrainian farmers and covering the salaries of Ukraine's first responders, all 57,000 of them. We were surprised to find that to keep it afloat, the US government is subsidizing small businesses.
Without weighing in one way or the other on origin of the virus, you've made clear that there's no consensus. Does the president believe, though, that the reward outweighs the risk when it comes to gain-of-function research?
Does the reward outweigh the risk when it comes to gain of research?
That type of research is proven.
I got a history degree. You're going to have to say that again.
Does the president believe that this type of gain-of-function research is proven?
He believes that it's important to help prevent future pandemics, which means he understands that there has to be legitimate scientific research into the sources or potential sources of pandemics so that we understand it, so that we can prevent them, and we can prevent them from happening, obviously. But he also believes, and this is why he wants the whole of government effort here to understand it, that research has to be done, must be done, in a safe and secure manner, as transparent as possible to the rest of the world, so people know what's going on. So I think that's a fancy way of saying yes.
My staff are idiots.
Documents, their authenticity nowhere challenged. That included a July 2017 WhatsApp message sent by Hunter Biden to Henry Zhao, a Chinese Communist Party official, which stated in its entirety, and I quote, "I am sitting here with my father, and we would like to understand why the commitment made has not been fulfilled. Tell the director that I would like to resolve this now before it gets out of hand, and now means tonight. And Z, if I get a call or text from anyone involved in this other than you, Zhang, or the chairman, I will make certain that between the man sitting next to me and every person he knows, and my ability to forever hold a grudge, that you will regret not following my direction. I am sitting here waiting for the call with my father," unquote. So just a couple of questions about this. First, does this not undermine the president's claim during the 2020 campaign and the reaffirmations of that claim by his two press secretaries since then, that he never once discussed his son's overseas business dealings with him?
No, and I'm not going to comment further on this.
James, let me save you some breath.
If you're going to ask about this, I am not addressing. I know you do more than I'd like you to have. I am not going to address this issue from this podium. I'm just not going to do it.
I'm
not
going to
do it.
Where was the president?
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Have a great weekend.
How would you say the administration's efforts to stem root flow, to get to the root causes of migration, have been?
We believe that we've done a good job working with our partners in the region to try to get at some of the root causes, including political instability and crime. There was a general decline in some of the migrant flows. Again, not perfect, not saying that it was down to a level that was comfortable for anybody, but there had been a decline.
Another thing is these crowds here in Eagle Pass have never been this large during my reporting. This is the most people I've ever seen in Eagle Pass, and other reporters, colleagues working other parts of the border in Arizona, in Hakumba near San Diego, tell me the same thing. We have these conversations, and the conversation is always, wow, I've never seen this number of migrants arriving. And we know from the reports coming from the government with these numbers. So we have the number of apprehensions, the numbers of encounters, everything spiking. So we don't know what this will mean moving forward. We just know that the numbers are much larger.
Some illegal border crossers are being given court dates in 2031. What are they supposed to do here for 7 years?
Again, that's a better question put to DHS. I'm not in a position to talk about specific cases like that.
151 people on the terror watch list have crossed our southern border.
The border is closed. The border is secure.
Given the fact that U.S. and Israeli intelligence did not pick up on this terrorist attack that happened in Israel, what is being done to lock down those individuals who now are somewhere in the United States?
I don't have any specific law enforcement actions to speak to today. Obviously, we monitor threats to our national security from inside and outside the country, all in real time. Law enforcement and intelligence community are watching as closely as they can and monitoring this. I would say, look, there's going to be a time and a place for us to take a look at the intel picture and what was known, what wasn't known. That's not the time now. The time now is to support Israel and make sure they have what they need
to
defend
themselves. But are we more concerned about attacks along these lines by terrorists here in the United States, given that we have 151 new people in the country who snuck across the southern border?
Always concerned about terrorist attacks on the American people here at home. That hasn't changed since 9/11. It's not going to change under this administration. Sorry.
I want to play this soundbite for you that is just last month in Vietnam and ask you if this still holds for the president. Watch.
And guess what? In addition to helping the environment overall, and the only existential threat humanity faces, even more frightening than a nuclear war, is global warming going above 1.5 degrees in the next 10 years.
Given all the nuclear players in these two areas where we are now engaged on, does the president stand by that comment?
Absolutely he does. Climate change is an existential threat. It could, it actually threatens and is capable of wiping out all human life on Earth over time. I mean, I don't know how more existential you can get to that, but that doesn't mean that we walk away from our obligations, our national security interests in very dangerous parts of the world.
You mentioned he said it was more frightening than a nuclear war. It's more frightening than a nuclear war in this moment?
The president believes wholeheartedly that climate change is an existential threat to all of human life on the planet. That's just science. That's a fact, Martha.
Why is the new DOD policy on abortion critical to military readiness?
I'm really glad you asked that question. No, I mean, I really am. 1 in 5 members of the U.S. military are women, 20%. We're an all-volunteer force. Nobody's forcing you to sign up and go. People volunteer to go. You raise your right hand and you say, I'm gonna do this for a few years or even for my life. And it might cost me my life to do it. And when you sign up and you make that contract, you have every right to expect that the organization, in this case the military, is gonna take care of you and they're gonna take care of your families. And they're going to make sure that you can serve with dignity and respect, no matter who you are, or who you love, or how you worship or don't. And our policies, whether they're diversity, inclusion, and equity, or whether they're about transgender individuals who qualify physically and mentally to serve, to be able to do it with dignity, or whether it's about female service members, 1 in 5, or female family members being able to count on the kinds of health care and reproductive care specifically that they need to serve. That is a foundational, sacred obligation of military leaders across the river. I've seen it myself, and it matters because it says we're invested in you because you are being willing to invest in us. You're investing your life, your family's livelihood with us. We owe you that back in return. I had a chance a couple of weeks ago to meet with some military spouses here at the White House. Some were active duty members, some were spouses, all were women. And 201, they told me, that abortion laws in this country that are now being passed are absolutely having an effect on their willingness to continue serving in uniform or to encourage or discourage, in this case, their spouses from continuing service. So if you don't think there's going to be a retention and a morale issue, think again, because it's already having that effect. I have a son in the Navy, I think you all know that, and son-in-law too. They're both stationed down in Norfolk on destroyers. You know, and they're proud to keep serving their country in the Navy, but you know, the Navy told them where to go. You go where you're told. That's the way orders work. You go where you're assigned. You don't get to choose. And so what happens if you get assigned to a state like Alabama, which has a pretty restrictive abortion law in place, and you're concerned about your reproductive care? What do? Do you say no and get out? Well, some people may decide to do that. And what does that mean? That means we lose talent, important talent. And we're, again, an all-volunteer force. Recruiting is tough enough as it is with a very strong economy out there. We want to keep the people that we get, and we want to make sure that they can continue to serve. So it can have an extremely extremely significant impact on our recruiting and our retention. Not to mention, it's just the right darn thing to do for people that raise their hand and agree to serve in the military.
Staff Sergeant Taylor Hoover's mom said that he reported to her that it was just chaos, the line of the chain of command was unclear, that they were sitting ducks, and we've heard other things since then. I think I understand that you'd rather talk, and the president would rather talk about the decision to end the war in Afghanistan. I think a lot of people are concerned about how it happened, the implementation of the withdrawal, and why it seemed so chaotic, and why warnings about suicide bombers might not have been heeded, and the rest.
Look, I think Central Command, who was the overarching military command, did a pretty exhaustive investigation of this, Jake, and they determined that barring any decision that could have impacted mission success, there wasn't much that could have been done to prevent that attack from coming, as tragic as it was.
That were killed in Pakistan, the weapons that the Taliban used were the weapons that the U.S. left in Afghanistan, okay. The goggles.
Seen those reports, but let me remind you, please, take the opportunity to remind you, we didn't just leave a bunch of weapons in Afghanistan. This is a fallacy, this is a farce.
Courtesy of Uncle Sam, American supplied armor, now riding under Taliban colors. Their ragtag desert army, now mechanized, even with the odd helicopter.
And look at what we left behind in terms of hardware. The American people paid for this.
And so for all this talk of chaos, I just didn't see it, not from my perch.
But then when we moved down to the actual gates, absolute chaos from the beginning.
Three minutes after the blast, a U.S. drone records the catastrophic aftermath.
The Taliban is not the North Vietnamese army. They're not remotely comparable in terms of capability. There's going to be no circumstance where you see people being lifted off the roof of a embassy of the United States from Afghanistan. It is not at all comparable.
Nobody's saying that everything was perfect, but there was a lot that went right, and a lot of Afghans are now living better lives in this country and other countries around the world.